Everywhere you look, there are brokenhearted people. Many have no joy, peace, or hope for the future. They're not only found on the streets and parks of your hometown, you'll also find them at work, mowing lawns, and driving kids to school. Isn't it time that we share our joy in Christ with those around us? Isn't it time that they know they are loved beyond all measure? Join the Gateway Band as together we sing, Somebody Loves Me.
Savior, and He's in love with me. He is with me from day to day. What a friend is He. Watches over me while I sleep. Hears me when I pray. I'm as happy as I can be, and now I can say, Somebody loves me, answers my prayers. I love somebody, I know He cares. Somebody tells me not to repine. That somebody is Jesus, and I know He's mine. You'll be happy if you will let Jesus have His way. He has work for us all to do every passing day. Feed the hungry and cheer the sad, for the sinner pray. You'll have joy that you never had, and then you can say, Somebody loves me, answers my prayer. I love somebody, I know He cares. Somebody tells me not to repine. That somebody is Jesus, and I know He's mine. Somebody loves me, answers my prayers. I love somebody, I know He cares. Somebody tells me not to repine. That somebody is Jesus, and I know He's mine. Yes, that somebody is Jesus, and I know He's mine.
Come and see a man from heaven. Come and see and hear Him speak. He has seen the face of God. Come and see, oh, come and see this Jesus of Nazareth. A still small voice deep inside, and a voice still ringing in my ear saying, follow me, oh, follow me, and I will show you my Father. See?
farmer and a teacher, a hooker and a preacher, riding on the midnight bus bound for Mexico. One was headed for vacation, one for higher education. Two of them were searching for lost souls. That driver never ever saw the stop sign. And 18-wheelers can't stop on a dime. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. I guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. That farmer left a harvest, a home and 80 acres, faith and love for growing things in his young son's heart. And that teacher left her wisdom in the minds of lots of children, did her best to give them all a better start. And that preacher whispered, can't you see the promised land? As he laid his blood-stained Bible in that hooker's hand. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. Guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. That's the story that our preacher told last Sunday, as he held that blood-stained Bible up for all of us to see. He said, bless the farmer and the teacher and that preacher who gave this Bible to my mama, who read it to me. There are crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, now I guess we know. You see, it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the
Better Life Broadcasting is a viewer-supported Christian media ministry that offers streaming programming via apps on various devices. Please visit blbn.org to support Better Life or to get more information. And don't forget to like and subscribe.
One day, a while back, I was driven by my schedule and I had not stopped to interact with others as I normally do. A friend of mine thought that I was mad at them. Simply put, this mission-driven pastor was sending off unintended signals. Life is like that sometimes. We all experience misunderstandings. Many have misunderstood the strength found in relationship with God and others revealed in the context of God's law. Join me now as I present the message, Misunderstandings. Once upon a time, there was a guy that went to this old country, kind of ghosty towny place that had people in it. And he was an artist, and he looked at the picture, at this scene, and he saw that it was getting to be close to sunset, and there was tumbleweeding like they do. And it was a dirt road, and he set up his easel, and he started to draw this picture. And out from, since this is a family show, out from the local ice cream parlor came a guy named Sam, and he walks by the artist, and all of a sudden he pulls out his gun, and since this is a family thing, it's a gun with the little suction cuppy dart thing in it, and he shoots the artist between the eyes. And the sheriff comes and starts to arrest Sam, and Sam says, well, he drew first.
Once upon a time.
What? Once upon a time this happened. I'm knocking off my... Man, you guys booed me so bad I knocked off my microphone. Misunderstandings. We are plagued with misunderstandings in this world. Why do we have misunderstandings, misdirection? We don't see the picture the way it is going to be. What's the reason we do that? What's that?
Frequency of notions.
Frequency of notions. Oh, it's the frequency of notions. I'm like, wow, that's above my head. Do you square that with something? I don't know. Preconceived notions. Yeah, I'm colorblind and deaf. So, preconceived notions. Misunderstandings come because we're in relationship. We can say something to someone else. And this is one reason why somebody that I worked with once really wanted everything that I communicated in email. And I get that. In business, it's good to have it in writing. But I hate to email somebody when I can walk down the hall and talk to them. Why is that? Because the tone of my email is up to you. Can you do, go, go, go? Well, how does that, could you do, or could you do, Well, if you know me, it's usually, well, could you do it? If not, I'll do it. Right? But we have these misconceptions that we find in life. And unless you're a hermit, you're going to be in some kind of a relationship. A relationship with our coworkers and with our neighbors and with our friends and our spouses and our children. We even have relationships with our dogs and our cats and our horses. And sometimes we can get into misunderstandings with them as well. I remember Denise and I don't fight. And we've been married 30, how many years, babe? This is our first fight, I can't remember. 34, I think I saw. 34 years, and we have yet to have a fight. We don't agree on everything, but we just don't fight. And somebody asked me one time, they said, well, how can you do that? And I said, well, we don't have any money, we don't have any children, what's there to fight about? Right? The closest that I can recall where I got a little snarky. Is that it? Can a boy be snarky? I know girls can be snarky. Can a boy be snarky? The closest I ever got to being snarky with Denise, I bought her a Konica camera for Christmas one time. And I'm out at the truck shop because back then I was driving the truck for a living. And I went out to the truck shop and I walk around the corner and here on a barrel, an old oil barrel sitting out in the rain is this camera that I just bought Denise for Christmas. And it's in the rain and it's just there. And I called her on the phone and I said, I just found the camera on the barrel. It's getting rained on. We must be more careful with our things. I'll see you tomorrow. Then I found out it wasn't her camera. It was my brother-in-law's camera. And ever since that time, I've been real careful with my words sometimes. Oh, let's see here. Where am I going? I don't know. My tab fell out. Oh, no, it did. Uh-oh. We are broke down. Ah, there we go. I want to go to Genesis. Genesis, chapter what? Chapter 1. You know, misunderstandings come because we receive bad data, don't we? We misinterpret what we're being told, and so often it gets us in trouble. We have what we would call stubborn expectations. I expect this, so I can't hear what somebody... Have you ever had somebody say, I will be there at such and such a time if I can? And then someone says, well, you will be there. Because we tend to want to hear what we want to hear, and we disregard all the stuff that we don't want to hear. We stop listening halfway through the conversation because we have decided this is the way I want it. And even though my wife or my friend or somebody has said, my boss has said, this is what it will be. Who likes it when your boss says, well, we'll talk about a raise if things get better in January. And you'll walk in and say, well, where's my raise? You said we'd talk about it in January. We forget the if things get better part. And so God said in Genesis
2, after he had made Adam, and this was before sin, and God said in Genesis 2, he said in verse 18, "And the Lord God said, it is not good for man that man should be alone, and I will give him a helper comparable to him. Out of the ground of the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird in the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them." And I didn't need to read all of that. It is not good for Adam, for man to be alone. But this was before sin. And then sin happened, and we're like, well, maybe it is pretty good for man to be alone. And we get over here to verse 12. And this is after the snake had convinced Eve to bite of the apple, and Eve took it to Adam. And this shows you how sin has changed the way that we look at the situation so quickly. When God came through and he said to Adam, he said, "Did you do this?" And Adam said, then the man said, "The woman whom you gave to me." In other words, the defective woman that you gave me. It's all her fault. It's not my fault. Because the woman whom you gave to me, gave to be with me, she gave me the tree to eat from. And God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" And then she said, "The serpent." And so when we live in this kind of a place in our minds where we have a hard time claiming ownership of our own problems, in Jeremiah 33:3, we need to get to the point in our lives where we can accept the things that God tells us. Not try to twist them in a way that fits our own worldview. Not try to change them. Is God implicit or explicit in what he tells us? That's a question. He doesn't mince his words. Now, we can get into prophecy study and all of those things, and we have to study deeper. And if we don't understand God's word, we have to drill deeper until we understand it. And that's by design, because God wants us to know him intimately. But God is explicit in the things that he says. And he says here, he says, "Call to me, and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things." You want to know the truth. You want to not misunderstand this God, this Father God, who we all claim to worship and put our hope and our trust in. Then we need to at least come before him regularly and call on his name. And says, what did it say again? "Call on me," he says, "and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things." Amen. There, Amy Grant had a song. What was that? It's a praise song. "Thy word is a lamp unto thy feet," right? Psalms 119, verses 105, starting in 105. "Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." We live in this world where we have misunderstandings because we haven't looked for God to give us the context of the world we live in. And the world that he desires for us and the life that he desires for us. We look at the things of God and we say, okay, but this fits with the way I want to be. And we say, well, we just misunderstand what God has told us to do. Rather than go to the word of God and "your word is the lamp unto my feet and the light unto my path, I have sworn and confirmed that I will keep your righteous judgments. I am afflicted very much. Revive me, O Lord, according to your word. Accept, I pray, the free will offering of my mouth, O Lord, and teach me your judgments. My life is continually in your hands. Yet I do not forget your law." The wicked have laid a snare for me, yet I have not strayed from you, from your precepts. Your testimonies I have taken as a heritage forever, for they are the rejoicing of my heart. I have inclined my heart to perform your statutes forever to the very end. This is a commitment of trust and a commitment of love that we've all been called to. We say a lot about the commandments of God as a people. And God's commandments are not a restriction to keep us from having fun. You know, Kip likes to have fun. But a way that God has called us to have a better life. Horizontally and vertically. And there's so many people in this world have misunderstood the commandments of God. Well, they're guidelines. You know, well, the church manual's a guideline. There's no conference people here today, I hope. But the commandments of God, written in stone by the finger of God, are not changeable. And I love it when we get here and get right down to the nitty-gritty of it in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37. And Jesus said, and this is when the scribe or the Pharisee had asked Jesus, which was the most important of the commandments. And Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment." Now, I got to tell you, is that implicit or explicit? Is that saying, well, you know, okay, well, God said love with all your heart and all your mind, so I guess I should pay God a little bit of attention. But that doesn't mean it's the most important thing I should do. What's the most important thing we should do? Love God with all our heart and all our mind and all our soul. What's the second most important thing to do? And it says, and the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Anybody here just bought a new car? Nobody wants to... Okay, you got a new car? Do you love me like yourself? My address is 2284, and I'll expect it in the morning. Love your neighbor on yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law of the prophets. The law is a way to show us how to live with each other and how to glorify God in it. And there should be no confusion there. There should be no a misunderstanding that you and I are in relationship and I need to love you with every fiber of my being as much as I love myself. And I can't do that because I know some of you. But God can do it through me. Because as we talked about in church this morning, that it's the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit that we ask for and that we long for or should and that we desire moment by moment as a daily request from God to fill me with His Spirit so that I can love all of you, including the difficult ones, like I love myself. And I love myself a lot. God is so good. And when I think about how this world has misunderstood God, Jesus Christ, my Savior, I look at the cross. There is nothing more explicit than the sacrifice that Christ made on the cross as He was suspended between heaven and earth to redeem you and me back to Him. As He paid that ultimate sacrifice, that ultimate price, so that you and I can be called, not later, but right this moment, sons and daughters of God. That's cool. That means I'm looking at a bunch of princes, which is okay, and a bunch of princesses, which is great. That also means that we also have an explicit work to do, be it through the gift of music, the gift of hospitality, the gift of friendship, the gift of prayer. What has God put on your heart to do for His cause? Because that's also not a misunderstanding. It's just a resistance in our heart to step forward for His cause. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love You so much. We want to understand You better, and for us to do that is not because You haven't spoken clearly, it's because we have listened poorly. And so, Lord, tonight I want to recommit my life, and I pray that those in this room would recommit their lives to focusing on what it is that You would have us to do for You, not as a burden, but as a joy in Your service. And go with us this evening, in Jesus' name, amen.
As always, thank you for joining us here at Boots and Bibles. It is our privilege to share our faith, hope, and joy in the soon return of Jesus Christ to all who will listen. Please send us some encouraging words or maybe a favorite song we could sing for you. As always, we look forward to joining you here every week to worship together. Don't forget to find us and like us on Facebook. Until next time, may God richly bless you and yours.
Life Broadcasting is a viewer-supported Christian media ministry that offers streaming programming via apps on various devices. Please visit blbn.org to support Better Life or to get more information. And don't forget to like and subscribe.